Today, we are going to talk about creating dynamic portraits with speedlights. And so, you know, in the world we live in today, when it comes to photography, we all agree everyone's a photographer. And in the spirit of that, we have to continuously look for ways to differentiate our studio, right? So we're an active studio in St. Louis, Missouri. We have to continuously look for ways to differentiate our studio and our brand from the competition. And it's been really interesting to watch the changes that have come across the industry over the last few years. So I do want to see a quick show of hands. How many people would consider themselves wedding portrait photographers? Doesn't matter if you're full-time or anything like that. So it's good to see a majority of the room doesn't, right? They feel like they're kind of below average when it comes to speedlights. And I think when we go through this, you're going to see how we're doing it and hopefully realize how simple we're making it, right? I don't want to overcomplicate it. And that's the one thing with my team. When we're working at an event, there's nothing worse than having this complicated lighting set up to make an image, right? Because if you're dealing with bride and grooms, that they don't have time for that, okay? So if you're doing weddings or even portraits, there's no worse feeling in the world than standing there, and tell me if anybody's ever been in this situation, you're standing there looking at your camera, you take a test shot with your speed light, and you look at the back of your camera, and you realize how horrible that picture looks, right? Yeah, I see a lot of heads nodding. And then you start panicking, right? And then you think you're a poker player and you got some poker face, right? And you try and move along that route. That's never going to work. We've got to be able to figure it out. I've been there, right? I've taken that shot. I'm like, oh, I was practicing at home. It looked great. Now I'm here in the field and all hell is breaking loose, right? So we've got to get a little more confident with it, and we'll talk about that. So if you want to follow us online, across all handles, we're at Sal Cincotta. So that's Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. And we like to do post a lot of behind the scenes. So what I want to do is, if you're not familiar with our work, is just start with a simple slideshow. one takeaway you should have is we focus on weddings, high school seniors, general portraits. And you should have seen across all those images, natural light, studio strobes, speed lights. And so we're gonna use the right tool for the job. It doesn't matter. I don't go into any specific shoot with a preconceived notion of what we're trying to, of what I want it to look like, right? So sometimes you gotta get out there into the field and get a feel for what the scene's gonna give you. And that's where having light is very, very important. In fact, I'll show you a picture of what's in the bag in a second here, but this is a LoPro X100 that I have here. And this has all my speed lights, all my battery packs, and everything with me just in this one little kit. And so I feel pretty confident that in this one kit, I can produce almost anything I need to produce, whether it's on a wedding day, corporate headshots, or anything along those lines. So quick overview of what we're gonna cover, who we are, what our goals are with our portrait and our clients. And I think that's also very important to understand. Do you have goals when you step out there with your clients? Or are you just going out there with your camera ready to shoot? Okay, if you don't have any goals, I'm not saying you have to figure out the entire photo shoot, but if you have no goals when you step out there to photograph, you're gonna run into a lot of problems on that shoot. You're gonna panic, you're not gonna have thought through what you're doing. So we'll talk a little bit about that as well. I'll show you what's in the bag. I'll talk to you about why we use speed lights, when to use speed lights versus strobes. Of course, you can always go out there with studio strobes as well and produce great images, but what's the right tool for the job? That's how you have to think about this. Ways to use speed lights to create that drama and stand out. I'm gonna show you several recent projects. So just in the last 2 weeks, we've had several recent projects that we've produced using speed lights, and I'm gonna show you what we did with those. And these are, one of them is for Hilton Hotel. And so we did a commercial shoot for them, all lit with speed lights. Many of you in the room have seen us on Creative Live or seen us in other places, so I apologize if this is repeat. I just always like to start with this. Shot my first wedding at about 17 years old, hated every single minute of it. Weddings, I'll date myself, I'm 45 years old, so we're going back into the 1980s. Weddings in the 1980s were not exciting, they were not fun, they were very stiff, this whole concept, right? Film, you're going back into the days of film. And so a typical wedding today will produce anywhere from 3,500 to 4,500 images. Back in the days of film, if we produced 600 images, we were crazy. We were overshooters back then. And so many things have changed over the years, which have brought me back into photography. Man, let me tell you what, there's nothing worse than photographing someone's wedding and having the wrong film or white balance in your camera and then going outside taking pictures and not realizing until you get everything back and everything's orange, or getting everything back and realize you had the wrong speed film in. And so these are the kind of, that was the pressure I did not want on myself. My family said, nope, you're not gonna be an artist, you're going to business school. So I graduated from Binghamton University. So I went, they shipped me upstate, and we talked a little bit before on why they might ship me out of state. But they shipped me upstate to Binghamton University, where I graduated School of Management. I worked in corporate, from my perspective, way too long. I worked for both Microsoft and Procter & Gamble. It's a big part of my pedigree. And so I came out of the corporate environment, and now it's funny because everything we do, I would say, is so anti-corporate because it's not what I want. It's not what I want for myself. It's not what I want for my team. What is Salvatore Cincotta Photography today comprises of 30 employees. And so when we started this business, in 2007, my wife and I started in our basement. I quit my job. I wanted to do what I loved. And today we have 30 employees. And so it's been really, really interesting to watch how our business has grown over the years. And we can certainly talk about that over the course of the next couple hours. We shoot about 35 to 45 weddings a year. So I'm still a very active photographer. I think that's very important if you're going to educate, to make sure that when you're up here teaching and speaking, that you can walk the walk and talk the talk. In our industry, unfortunately, there's a lot of frauds, I will call them, in our industry, because they're not active shooters. They're just professional educators. And there's nothing wrong with that, right? But at the end of the day, it depends on what you're teaching. If you're teaching lighting, okay, we can work with that. But if you're gonna stand up here and teach business, you can't really teach business if you shoot 2 portrait sessions a year and 5 weddings a year. What business are you possibly teaching me? Our peak was about 55 weddings a year, and that was just with myself and my wife, and it was pretty miserable. We were coming in, right? You gotta remember, don't think for a minute this is one wedding every weekend. That's not what it is. Because wedding season in the Midwest is probably very much like it is here. We were shooting weddings from May through October. And so in that 6-7 month window, we had to produce 55 weddings. So we would shoot a wedding on a Friday, two weddings on a Saturday. My wife would shoot her own, I would shoot mine, and then one wedding Sunday. No lie, we did that for about 2 years, and it was, we're like, no more. 35 to 45 is about the right number for us. We do portraits, seniors headshots, team shots, environmental, and then some commercial work. Commercial work is great when you can get it, but it's just not what our business is built on. And so we'll always remain active. We talked about it before we came up. We are we own Shutter Magazine. If you've not heard of that, there's a paid version of it. It's printed. It's probably one of the best printed magazines out there. And then there's a free version of it, which is all online. Go to behindtheshutter.com, and I think you'll be pretty impressed with the level of education that's in that magazine. Education is a big part of what we do. So I love educating. I love teaching people. I think we have the best jobs in the world, by the way. How many of you in here are full-time photographers? Okay. How many are part-time, want to go full-time? Yeah. So if you're part-time, want to go full-time, in my opinion, and even the full-timers, I think we have the best jobs in the world. Every day we get to wake up and do what we love. We get to work with people, some crazy, right? Some not. We get to work with a lot of cool people and do a lot of cool things. And so for me, I never, ever want to go back to corporate America. That's not what I want to do. I've left that life. I can't even imagine being locked to a desk or in a cubicle ever again. That would be insanity for me. This is our headquarters. And so this is in O'Fallon, Illinois. It's a 100-year-old building. We own the building. It's not bad. It's cool digs. Bottom floor is Salvatore Cincotta Photography. So on the right-hand side, that's our actual studio. That's where we still do our commercial shoots, any indoor stuff, high school seniors, portraits, headshots, bridal portraits possibly. It just depends on the client. Left-hand side, there's a room there, which you can't see, and that's where our clients actually come in to do in-person sales presentations. And so we used to post everything online, right? We're not talking business today, but this is where our clients come. Second floor is admin space. Third floor, we own an editing company. They are up there. And today we've actually outgrown this business. And so, or this building, sorry. Within the next 6 months, more than likely we will double in size of employees. And we've just purchased two new buildings in our town to handle that growth. So it's been, photography has been good to us, that's for sure. And so our goals, when we come back to shooting, okay, so that's just kind of a little high level of who we are and where we've come from. And by the way, I share that with you, not as a pat on the back. Anyone who knows me and knows why I teach, I share that with you so you understand what's possible. All too often, you know, we're taught as artists that, you know, we're starving artists, man. I don't want to be a starving artist. That sucks. That sounds horrible. I want to be successful. I want to make money. I want finer things in life. I want to retire someday. You want to put your kids through school. I don't have kids, so I don't want to put them through school. All of us want things, right? Look at us. We're here at B&H. Tell me, as you're walking through here, you're not drooling about things you want, both on the way in and on the way out, right? So these are the kind of things we want, but how do we fund these things? The money's got to come from somewhere. And so we can't be apologetic for trying to run a successful business. That's the part we have to get rid of that. We have to think positively about making money and think it's okay. It's not a bad thing to make money. And so here's our goal when we step out on a portrait shoot. Every time we step out to make an image, it's got to be with some level of purpose. So if we just go out there and you're one of those photographers who's just like, oh, look at the buildings. They're so pretty. And oh, wow, there's a tree and there's grass and it's park. You got to stop. You got to shake that off, right? Can you imagine if you went into a restaurant? And every time you went into a restaurant, the chef was like, oh, well, we can use dandelions and lavender. And we, no, I want a steak. Make the steak. Season the steak. Put it on a plate. Put it in front of me. That's all I want, right? Well, think about it from a photography perspective. You've got to come up with that formula, that recipe. Stop believing that every time you step out, you have to reinvent the wheel. I just think that's a misnomer in our industry. We don't have to reinvent the wheel. Clients come to us because of what they see on our website, right? Good, better, and different. They come to you because of what you see on your website. Why do you want to try and produce something that's different than what's on your website? So for us in our studio, 80%, 90% of what we do is the same every time. 10% becomes the variable, the creative interpretation of the scene, of lighting, of what you want to do. But our wedding clients who hire us, our high school senior clients who hire us, they're not looking for us to reinvent the wheel every single time we get out there. And so when we go out, it is with purpose. And guess what that purpose is? To make money. We step out, we shoot to sell. That's a mantra you'll hear me say many, many times. Shoot to sell, right? So I get in trouble a lot, I'll tell you with what? High school seniors. High school seniors always come to the shoots and they've got like sunglasses on, right? I just think it looks badass, okay? And so they'll be there with their sunglasses on and I wanna get them doing like just mean mugging and just doing cool stuff. Doesn't sell. Does not sell. Why do you think it doesn't sell? Parents don't buy it. I think it's the coolest shot in the world. Oh my God, this is awesome. It'd look great as a big shot. And mom's like, I can't see her eyes, right? So it doesn't sell. So I can do what I want to do in my 10%, but then I have to do what needs to be done in that 90 to sell, to make money. So every time we step out there, it has to be with purpose. How many, I already asked you guys this, how many are doing weddings, glamour, seniors, other? High school seniors is this huge untapped market, by the way, here. It's a funny story, I've told it before. Again, born and raised in New York, so my mother is from New York, and she asked me one time, she's like, what are you teaching about? I said, well, I'm teaching about seniors. She's like, really? I'm like, yeah. I'm like, it's a huge market. And my mom's 65. So my mom goes, so should I be getting ready for my pictures? Like, when should I be doing this? My mom immediately thought I was talking about seniors as in senior citizens, right? Because in New York, in California, the concept of a senior session doesn't really exist. But that doesn't mean you shouldn't go after it. That means there's opportunity there. Here's why there's opportunity. We're in New York City, fashion capital of the world. You're telling me that these kids who are watching Tyra Banks on America's Next Top Model, you're telling me they don't want to have a fashion session, a model session, call it whatever you want. Definitely don't call it senior session, okay? Call it whatever you want. But if you put together this high fashion portrait session for these teens, they will respond, I promise you, because they see it, they live it every single day. Every teen, no matter where you are in the world, it's not an America thing. No matter where you are in the world, teens want to be cool. And so I think there's an opportunity there. But again, we've got to go out with purpose. We can't just go out and wander around a park with a high school senior and hope to get something good. And so hopefully we understand all that. And so why purpose is so important, right? We're going to talk a little bit of business. I know we like seeing pretty pictures and flashes and all that stuff go off. But purpose is going to help define your brand. It's part of messaging. When you attract clients into your studio, believe it or not, lighting becomes part of your brand. The use of or the lack thereof, it becomes part of your brand. If you're a natural light photographer and then all of a sudden you put a flash shot on your site, one, it's probably not going to look good because you didn't know what you were doing or you got really lucky. Okay, or it just doesn't fit into what you're doing. There's a disconnect there. And so if you want to connect with the right client, how many people have heard me say that before? The right client, okay? That's the client who appreciates what you're bringing to the table. Well, how can they appreciate what you're bringing to the table if everything you bring to the table is different when I'm on your website and looking at your slideshows, right? Or looking at your portfolio on your website. One image is a picture of a shoes, one image is a picture of a necklace, one image is photojournalistic with her crying, hugging her mom, one image is like this big dramatic shot. Which is it? Who are you? What is your brand? Define your brand. And so you may like my work, you may not like my work, but one thing we should be able to agree on is if you go to salcincotta.com, our website, it's consistent. Consistently bad, consistently good, I don't know, it all depends on how you feel. But at the end of the day, it's consistent. So one thing I know I'm really good at is connecting with the right client. That is what we are good at. And so at the end of the day, what's really funny is when clients come in and meet with us. Almost, I don't want to say every client, let's say half the clients who come in to meet with us, they will ask me, wedding specifically, if we shoot the entire wedding. Because on our website, you will not see pictures of shoes. On our website, you will not see pictures of moms crying and hugging and all these photojournalistic shots, which by the way, we take. We document the entire day. But what we show are those big dramatic portraits that you saw in that slideshow. Because that's my client. I want the client who wants to come in and put something this big on their wall. If you're looking for a bunch of 8x10s, I'm not interested. It's just not what I want. That's not my client. I know who my client is. And so even at bridal shows, okay? At bridal shows, what are we gonna talk about there? We're gonna talk about those big dramatic shots that I have in my booth. I'm never gonna have somebody at a bridal show stop me and be like, can we talk a little bit more about the picture of the shoes you have there? Oh, they're amazing. I'm gonna get a pair of Christian Louboutins, and I love the way you photograph shoes. Guys, this is not gonna happen, right? They wanna talk about those big dramatic images, your style. And so lighting becomes branding, right? What makes your image better than mine, by the way? Are you a better photographer than me? I don't know. I don't really care. Am I a better photographer than you? I don't know. It's all up to the, beauty's in the eye of the beholder, right? Matters what the bride sees, matters what your senior sees, it matters what your portrait client sees. Maybe you're a glamour, portrait photographer, whatever it is. What is going to distinguish your brand from everything else? And so how are you going to be better than your competitors? Because at the end of the day, a tree is a tree, a park is a park, a brick wall is a brick wall. So we can all go outside, okay, and take a picture of a bride, of a portrait on a brick wall. Are they all gonna look the same? Does everybody agree they will not look the same? There's no way, right? They will not look the same. We could all go with the same camera, the same lens, the same lighting, okay, natural light, and all of us will take different images. They will look different because we're artists. It's open to interpretation. Well, lighting becomes part of that. How you use lighting becomes a big part of your brand. And that's the part I want to compel you to do differently. And so that becomes the constant, light. Without light, we can't even make an image, right? It's just 101 to photography. We need light. Now, what does that mean? Can we use a flashlight? Can we use video light? Yes. That becomes the tool of the trade, not the camera. The camera, we all have the same cameras. We all have access to it. The lenses, we all have access to the same lenses, okay? It's definitely not the memory cards, the editing. It really comes down to how we're using light to shape and create an image. And so ultimately, I believe it's your brand. And so we all know how I feel about natural light, right? Translation, I call BS on it. It just means you don't know what the hell you're doing with light, or it scares the crap out of you and you don't want any part of it. And so we got to get past that. And so my particular style when it comes to lighting is I love a hard-edged light. That's my style. You're more likely to see me with a bare bulb, right? And so you're more than likely to see me with a speed light just like this. No softbox, no real modifiers on them. That's my style of light. You got to figure out what yours is. You know, we could put softboxes on this, octaboxes on it. We can do whatever you want to do. They make it, okay? What is your style? And so that's my particular style. I like dramatic portraits. I like surreal or semi-surreal look and feel. To me, when we use the word surreal, I start thinking like composites. And that's not really my style of photography. I'm not looking to create fantasy, right? Just semi-fantasy. And I think you see a little bit of that in my imagery. I want to create a centerpiece for their home, art for their home. My goal, every single event, high school seniors, weddings, no matter what I'm photographing, my goal is to create one image, to define their event. Isn't that an interesting mindset? You've got to change the way you're thinking. And so we go out there, I'm going to document the whole wedding. Oh, yep, mom's crying. I didn't see that coming. Okay. Oh, bride's coming down the aisle. That was a shocker. We didn't know that was happening. Oh, look, they're saying I do at the altar. Wow. Exciting. There's no art in that. We've got to, eventually it just becomes the same monotonous thing every Saturday. And so, sorry. Hopefully my brides aren't watching. So what I do is to challenge myself. Remember what I said, 80 to 90% of that wedding should be shot the same every single Saturday. Yes, we're gonna be in a different location. Yes, we're gonna be in a different hotel, a different church, a different dress, a different couple. But the documentation and the coverage for me is gonna be the same within 85 to 90%. With that 10%, that's where I'm chomping at the bit. That's where I wanna have fun. That's where I wanna pull out the lights to do cool stuff with. That's what you've gotta challenge yourself to do. Find that one shot that you can use to define the event for the couple. You do that, you're gonna be extremely successful, because I promise you, when you make that your mindset, you'll always walk away with more than one image. It's very difficult when you're thinking that way to walk away with one image. And that becomes the challenge. And so speed lights, right, become a tool of choice. Incredibly light, portable, and reasonably powerful. Just depends on what you're looking to accomplish, right? Speed lights typically gonna put out about 60 watts per second. It's not a studio strobe, right? It's not gonna put out 500 watts per second, 1,000 watts per second. So you have to understand where you're using it, how you need it, and what the limitations of that tool are, right? So of course, if I'm using a speed light and I'm out, you know, in sunlight and it's F16, okay, the closer I get, the more powerful it's gonna be. The further away I get, we're gonna have some issues. So that maybe that dictates lens choice, right? So if you're gonna go with a wide shot, 16-35, how far away you get from the scene, you're either editing out your assistant in the shot, okay, because they gotta be super close, or you need 2, 3, 4 speed lights, or you need a studio strobe to put out the right kind of power. You've gotta understand what the tool can do and when the right time to use it is. Hence, understanding their limitations. The other issue you're gonna deal with is recycle time, okay? This comes down into power again. So if I'm back here trying to light up a bunch of people, this is gonna be firing full power, okay? Recycle time, about 5 seconds. Holy cow, man. 5 seconds? Think about it. 1-1000, 2-1000, 3-1000, 4-1000, 5-1000. You wanna talk about awkward with your clients? Like, what do? You take the shot and say, hey, did you guys catch a game last night? It was cool. What are you doing? Right? So you've got to come up with a solution for that. So we use Cyclone battery packs. Okay, I'm gonna show you what's in our bag. This gives us 1 second recycle time. Okay? And so this helps us deal with the limitations of this, right? We're not plugging these into a wall. And so sometimes, like I said, that tool's a speed light, other times it's a strobe. And so here's what we carry in this bag you're looking at right up here. 5 Canon 600 EXs, okay? If I could have 10, I would carry 10. I would definitely can find a way to use them. I use a Canon transmitter. Okay, so this is their RT, right? This is their transmitter. This is gonna go on the camera. It's gonna control everything. You can over and under expose. What I would not recommend, and this is why I like the 600s, but what I would not recommend is using this as your trigger, which you can do, by the way. So you can use one of your speed lights to control the other speed lights, but you're killing, right, a $500, $600 unit just to be a controller, and that's not what you want to do. Because typically, if this is on camera, I would not use it to light my subject on camera. Always get this thing off your camera, guys. On camera, rookie 101, okay? We've got to get this off the camera. So if this is ever sitting on my camera, more than likely, I'm just covering either first dances, right? Where I'm not firing it directly, of course. I'd be bouncing it off the ceiling. But usually when I'm trying to create dramatic portraits, it's not on the camera. So we don't want this to be that transmitter. So invest in that transmitter. Huge fan, I mean huge fan of MagMod. Anybody using MagMod in here? Oh, I'm about to change your world. All right, here's MagMod. You wanna talk about cool light modifiers? Okay, so here's my strobe. You want a grid? Here's our grid, right here. Piece of rubber, ridiculous magnets. Boom, done, grid. Oh, wait a minute, you wanna stack those grids? Go for it. You wanna keep narrowing how much that light is coming out? Those are your grids. Wait a minute, you wanna gel it? Okay, so now I can put a gel right on top of that. That's how easy it is, okay? So I'm a huge believer in carrying these light modifiers there. You're not using these either?
No, now I need to get them.
Now you need to get them. So quick story, right? I saw a bunch of people using these at Shutterfest. I'm like, it's just a gimmick, right? And then all of a sudden I had a photo shoot and I'm like, I need a little bit more control. And I borrowed them and I got my hands on them and I'm like, yeah, we're gonna use these. Very, very controllable. You wanna change your gels? Notice here, I apologize, this isn't a promotion for MagMod. But notice here, right, I've got a blue gel here. If I wanna change that gel, just pops right out, okay? Super, super easy to control and stack and adjust, which is what you want. None of us out in the field, here's the one thing that can't happen. The tool can never get in the way of the job. The tool is meant to enhance your skill. And so if you find yourself fumbling and trying to control all these different products that you've bought because people like me have told you you need them and you're not actually using them, well, then that defeats the entire purpose. And so what you're gonna see is how we actually use these in production, because I had a photo shoot for Hilton Hotel, and I used these products there in a way that I would not have been able to get the shot any other way. I would not have been able to get the shot as fast as I got it using strobes. So we used those Bolt battery packs, the Manfrotto Nano stands, one of the best light stands ever created, in my opinion. You wanna talk, they fit in a suitcase. So no matter where we're photographing, I have those Nano stands with me. And so they're about 50 bucks. I'll show you a picture that has them in there. 50, maybe I'm lying, maybe 50, 70 bucks. And we carry about 3, 4, 5 of those with us. so that we can put all the speed lights on stands, much better than normal light stands. And then of course, all of this is in the LowPro X100. And so this just becomes a carry-on we're bringing with us wherever we're going. And so what we're gonna do is I'm gonna show you how exactly we're incorporating these into shoots. So I'm gonna show you a commercial shoot we did recently, a portrait shoot we did recently, and then how we're doing it with weddings and engagements. And I think that's gonna give all of you, right, just this plethora of information of how we're incorporating this into our actual shoots. And so this is a real shoot we did about a week and a half ago, 2 weeks ago. So the images are not edited, okay? What you're seeing is raw, down and dirty images, but you're gonna see good lighting. And so we were hired by Hilton Hotel in St. Louis to create some lifestyle shots for them. We're working with their ad agency on this shoot, which was really cool. They had no real budget whatsoever, right? Welcome to the world of photography. Nobody has money. We ended up eating 90% of their budget, of the budget they did have, 90% of it went to us. So no real models. All the models that showed up were friends of family and like it was just hodgepodge of people showing up. No makeup artists, no hair, nothing like that. So, I mean, the models had hair, but no hair and makeup artists. So the goal, they needed roughly 5 shots of the property and people in it for advertising. So here's the challenge for some of their properties. Some of the properties they have are dated, okay, and you'll see what I mean by that, and they need a way to start attracting youth, right? We all understand youth is where the money is. Sorry. I mean, that's just reality, right? If you're, I mean, I don't even qualify. I'm 45. You know what I'm not doing? Hanging out at the Hilton Hotel bar. It's just not my thing. And so they want these 20-something-year-olds coming to their bar, hanging out. So we gotta make this look like a fun environment, right? You're not gonna see like these big shots that somebody would put on the wall. What you're gonna see is a way of portraying the image for commercial advertising, right? So we're dealing with their art direction that's there and making sure we're getting the shots they need. So we show up on the first scene. This is literally what it looks like to the naked eye. How do we make this look good? So I hate to tell you what choice of 4-letter words I chose when I walked in, but I was like, I started going into panic mode. How do I make this look good? It is this horrible environment. The furniture is horrible. What's the name of this place, by the way?
Cheshire.
It's called the Cheshire Hotel. So it's a very old 60s themed, like wood beams, like really, really dated. What's that style of architecture called? You know what I'm talking about? What is it? No, it's not Art Deco. That would have been amazing. You'll see it in a second. So this is what we're looking at. There's a fireplace there, believe it or not. So look at that couch, huh? So what I started doing was I started one light at a time. So we started building the environment. So we are using our nano stands. And by the way, I want to explain to you the size of this space. I don't think you have perspective. I am literally standing here taking an image. Alyssa is sitting right where this first row is. That's my space. There's no more space for me to go back. That wall that you're seeing there is maybe where you are in that third row. That's it. So light, you can't just pop a flash off in there, okay, and not light the entire room and make it look like amateur hour, right? You've got to have control. So we had 4 speed lights, 1 for each person. Believe it or not, there's 4 chairs there. Okay, so 1 speed light for each person. And then we started building. Now, mind you, I'm in a bar that is still active, by the way. They could not shut down any of the spaces for us to work in. So we had to deal with that situation as well. So we were moving customers to different spots and giving them free food in order to accomplish what we were doing. So that was getting her dialed in at number 1. Okay? Then what I did, So then that was bare. That's her at number 1. So now we've got 1 light on her with a grid. So what we're doing is we had this one, no gels, nothing like that, and just a grid on a nano stand, lighting her up, okay? We're probably firing at about 1/28th power, okay? So we didn't even need battery packs to recycle, right? You didn't need a whole lot of power in here. You could see the fire in the shot, right? Big glowing fire. I mean, look at all the, no, it doesn't exist. It's a horrible fire. How do we make this look good? How do we make this look inviting? That was becoming a problem. Also, notice all that dark space up top just going black. So my next shot, I go, there was this big, like, I don't know, 18th, 19th century chandelier. So I took a speed light, put the feed on it, and I just had it up there firing into the ceiling, and it created an interesting kind of design on the wall, but I'm like, yeah, it's just not, still not looking good. So then the next shot, you're seeing we're lighting somebody in the second chair. So we start building what we're doing. Next shot, this is where it kicked in. I took another speed light, gelled it, and put it back under that table and fired it into the fireplace. And now all of a sudden that went from just this blah to this nice warm glow out of the fireplace. Okay? That became the final shot that we produced for him. Everybody's well lit. Remember, these are not edited at all. Everybody's well lit. We've got a nice warm glow. All that from this. We understand what we did there? Art director, loved it. Saw the one shot, done, wrap, next scene. Okay, remember, we're working in an active bar. This would not be possible. And by the way, the girl on the right, she doesn't even work for anybody. She was somebody who was at the bar that the agency asked, hey, you're pretty, can you step into this ad? It's not good when you're trying to produce an ad and maybe your employees aren't the best looking people in the world. I don't know. But So this becomes the shot we produce. She loves it. And we go on to the next scene. So this is the next scene. This is the actual bar. And so what I did is on this shot, I just cranked up the exposure so you could see what we're looking at here. Does this look like where a 20-something-year-old would want to go hang out? Let's go hang out there, man. That bar is super cool. Right? And when you're in there, I can tell you the difference between what your eye is seeing and what the camera is seeing is somewhere in between this and this. So it's not necessarily that dark. I think it's hard to see on the screens here with the lights. And it's definitely not that bright. But there's no mood to it. There's no reason I'd want to go there and grab a drink. It's very dated, as you can see. And so we decided, isn't that cool? Suddenly, if you're 20-something, you're like, this place is hip, right? They're going to be pissed when they show up. Because it does not look like that at all. And so what we had to do here was, remember, this was an active bar. We had to get people and keep moving them away from the bar and move as quickly as possible to get the shot. We had to kick the bartenders out from behind the bar. In order to get the shot. So we're dealing with time constraints. I don't have an hour to set up a shot and bring in all these studio strobes. And by the way, studio strobes in this particular environment, no scenario they're working. You are not gonna be able to dial them down enough to not have light literally everywhere. And so the way this was lit, to give you perspective, you can see the settings up top in the left. I left them there. They are at a 40th of a second, okay, F4. ISO 320, I shot this with my 2470, okay? The strobes, what you're seeing there is there's a strobe on the floor, okay, firing up into the ceiling in between each of the two beams. Are you seeing how that light is getting just trapped up there? The fifth light is right behind her head here. I don't know if you can see this, the girl in the center of the frame, firing right at her. And that's what lit everyone up. So when we were firing just the four into the ceiling, all you saw, all that light was getting lost up in those beams. Nothing was coming down, okay? So we started with the four lights on the nano stands firing straight up into the ceiling, okay? And then that fifth one firing directly at her. Now, when we were starting, can everybody see this in my mouse up here? We tried to do it with three lights, but what was happening is we were actually lighting the beam and then not enough light was making its way into those kind of recessed areas. And so we had to get one into each area. And if you look really closely, you can see the color is a little different as you go to each one. I didn't have enough of the same color gel. And so we had to just use what we had in that particular situation. And then that fifth one was right here sitting on the countertop, firing right back into everybody to get the look we wanted. So we had three or four different locations we had to shoot for them, okay? So this was hotel number one. I had to do four setups. Oh yeah, this is location number two. I had to do four setups in one day. And so we had to keep moving quick, get models to the next location, right? Make sure we had clearance at the next location. So this is Union Station, Hilton Hotel, so home of Shutterfest. So this is where we host Shutterfest. Yeah, that's right, Shutterfest.
Yeah. Shutterfest is here.
That's right. And so they brought us in to photograph it. Just so you guys know, it's not part of this, but part of this shoot, we had the drone flying indoors in Union Station. And you want to talk about chaos breaking loose. All of a sudden, that drone's there. Within, I don't know, 2 minutes, security standing right next to me. And he was trying to be all nice about it. He's like, excuse me, sir. And I'm like, right, I'm watching my drone. And I'm moving like this because inside Union Station, you can't get any GPS signal. So what happens is, I don't know if any of you are using drones, but the drones today can sit there and hover within 6 inches, right? Just sit there and hover if it gets signal from the GPS satellites. Well, inside Union Station, we could only connect to 2 satellites. So it was not hovering. I mean, it was literally drifting everywhere. And in the back of my mind, I'm like, today's the day. Today's the day I make the news for all the wrong reasons, right? And I'm like on just laser focus patrol because I'm watching this thing drift. And then I'm like, oh my God, the whole place is filled with customers. They didn't clear this area for us. And so I'm just watching this thing and everybody down below is watching me, watching the thing. And then I got security next to me. He's like, sir, can I help you? And I'm thinking to myself, can you help me? I'm flying a drone. I don't really need your help. You know I'm flying a drone. I know I'm flying a drone. Get to your question. His real question is, what the hell are you doing? Right? And so I'm just like, I'm like, yeah, dude, what's up? How can I help you? He's like, well, what are you doing? I'm like, I'm flying a drone, man. And so I'm like, dude, do me a favor. Talk to your management. They all know I'm here, right? And I'm just the whole time, I'm like watching up there. Good news is we didn't crash the drone. And then we brought it down and then we had to get to this scene, right? So we cleared this one area. And what you're seeing here are the 4 lights we have set up, right? And they're on these nano stands. So I don't know if you can really see them here. Very portable. They collapse to about this big. Okay, so really, really cool. I don't know if anybody here can get us one. I think they got one or two of those laying around here at B&H. But if we can get one, it's about this big. They collapse, super easy to use, super lightweight. And like I said, I think they're anywhere from like $55 to $70 per. So we set up these 4 lights. They're all gridded, okay? And so what we're looking to do is capture the magnitude of the situation, right? The ceilings, the coloring. And this is where using speed lights, okay, and understanding how to control them matters. Because if you don't let in this ambient light up in here, quickly, that all turns black. And then that's not what they want. So if you're trying to produce something like this, where you're trying to show the enormity of the situation, you're trying to show the coloring of there, you've got to let that ambient light in. And so you'll see in the next shot, okay, this was shot at a 20th of a second. So this is handheld, 20th of a second, ISO 1600, in order to get that ambient light in the room. So this becomes signature for them, okay, showing that up on that ceiling. They also do slideshow presentations on the ceiling, which we had to capture that as well. Well, if we were lighting here, just in this area, we would lose all of this ambient lighting in the room. Does everybody understand that? So this becomes really important. So what you want to do first is meter for the room, right? We've got to know what the room is, and at a 20th of a second, handheld, okay, the people are going to be blurry. The flash is going to freeze that. And that's where we brought in the 4 speed lights on this. That becomes our shot. Now this color, I know you're looking at the ceiling and you're going, wait a minute, it's purple, now it's red. The reason that happened is because that color is changing in the room, right? So what we didn't adjust the color, that color is changing. And so we've got a bunch of different frames where that ceiling, the lights, everything is still there. We've not lost any of that detail. And they're all well lit. And if we zoom in, we can see beautiful light on their faces, not a whole bunch of crazy spill all over the place, right? Where we're gonna have to fix this, remember, these are raw images. They have not been edited yet. So where we're gonna fix this is we're gonna burn this down. See that hot spot there, right? That's from some light spill, and that's gonna happen. But if I'm in there with a studio strobe, light spill is everywhere. I'm lighting, look at the carpet. Notice we're not lighting over blasting the carpet down here. So we've got control over that light. And again, you're talking about this power source. And these are being lit at 128th, 164th power. And that's the beautiful part about working with these, that I can control that. Now, if this same scene were outside by a pool, this is not the right tool for the job, okay? Depending on if I got battery packs or we're shooting much slower. And so we've got to understand where the capabilities are. First of all, notice speed. Had to move very quickly. 4 to 5 different scenes that we had to be in. I only showed you 3 of them. Small footprint. We were in an active hotel. We did not have hours to set up strobes to make a shot like this work. You go on a true commercial shoot. I don't know if any of you have ever been on a real commercial shoot. There's setup happening hours beforehand, okay? They're testing every scenario, and then the models show up, they get out of the makeup chair, boom, shoot's over in like 10 minutes, move on to the next scene, okay? So we didn't have that luxury here. We had to get all these scenes shot, and we had minimal time to set up. Minimal power needed, like I said, a 64, 30-second power, so we weren't even killing the batteries because we weren't running at full power. So the next one are headshots. So maybe you're doing corporate work, limited space, using groups becomes key. And so what we did is we went into our studio, okay, great background, and we just started producing headshots using different tools. And so here's the light setup in ratios. First, these are all speed lights, by the way. So 6 speed lights, and you're seeing the settings. So we metered them all in, no ETTL, all different groups. So the front side of this, group A, the hair light, group B, the kicker lights, group C, and the background light, group D. Okay, so this allowed me from the controller, okay, and if you have this, now from this controller, I can actually go to each group and adjust that group manually. And that becomes really, really important. Sure, you can sit there and meter in all you want, but then when you take that first frame and you actually have a subject standing there, you gotta make adjustments. No matter how well you think you're metered in. The person that was standing there, maybe the light doesn't look, maybe they're fair skinned. Maybe they're darker skinned. Okay, so now I need more light. Everything is completely controlled from this unit. So I'm not going yelling to my assistants to go and start adjusting power settings. Everything is adjusted here, and I can see the ratios all from this unit. So to me, very, very powerful system, solution. Those are the key words, those are the words you want to use when you're thinking about stuff like this. What is the solution for you to shoot? Now, the other part of that solution, remember, when I showed you that commercial shoot, everything was pretty much pinpoint controlled light using grids and using the bare strobe. For this particular one, we didn't want that kind of light. We wanted, it was one subject, we wanted a softer light. So we're using the Westcott Rapid Box. I don't know if any of you are using this stuff. I'm a huge fan of it. We're using their strip boxes. Okay, and what I like, this is the Westcott Rapid Box. It'll put two speed lights will fit in there. It doesn't matter if you're Nikon, Canon. You can put 2 speed lights in there so you can really get some power into one of these and use it outdoors. Right? 1 speed light outdoors, depending on what you're doing, becomes really tough. So this allows you to put 2, and then it's an octa box. And so we litter, combined light here is at 5-6. Okay, so we wanted beauty lighting. We didn't want a hard edge light for this. And you'll see what it looks like in a second. Okay, we got the 2 edge lights. We want to create separation. Okay, we got a hair light, and then we've got that background light because we don't want that to go black. Everything makes sense what I'm setting up here? Okay, this is that shot, completely unedited. Okay, so you're seeing the raw shot. Are you seeing the separation? Look at the separation in her hair to the background. Look at the lighting under her nose. Okay? Not butterfly lighting. Okay, you got some loop lighting. You're gonna see that under her nose. Very much a beauty style portrait, okay? So the ratio here is 1 to 1 to 1. Okay, maybe it's just under 1 to 1. And so what we're looking to do is just produce just a beautiful, flattering light on our subject. So if we're doing portraits, real estate headshots, corporate headshots, right? We're not looking for dimensional lighting here. We're not looking to really do anything but beauty, especially for a high school senior, right? That's not what they're looking for. Maybe if it's a boy, we would do something a little bit different, and I'll show you that. But so this is it. Notice the separation in her arm. See that edge light there? But also realize there's a 2-stop difference. So a lot of times you see people putting edge light on their subject, and it's so blown out. I don't know if you realize that. That's because you're just not lighting it correctly. You're just throwing too much power at it. So remember, when we go back to this, this main light is at 5-6. The camera's exposing at 5-6. Those edge lights there are at 2-8. So we're looking at a 2-stop difference. I just wanted it to be subtle, right? A lot of times you see that light coming forward. It's this hard white light on the side of their face, on their shoulder. it actually becomes distracting. That's just a bad use of light. Now, if you want to say that's your style and that's the way you want to work it, more power to you. But at the end of the day, we've got to control what the light is doing. And remember, there's no battery packs on these. So these are all being lit with AA batteries. No problem at all with performance. Okay? Sharp as a tack. You're seeing the catch lights in her eyes. You're seeing how the hair is being lit on her head. And you're seeing our settings there. ISO 200, 5.6, 1/200th of a second. Is this making sense? So then we go, okay, right? We're using speed lights. We want to try different things. We want to create different looks with our speed lights. So then we went with just the Octobox, okay? And then one light. And so that's how she's being lit. Now notice the difference in the way the shape of the light is on her face. So just by adjusting where the light is and not pushing that fill in underneath, right? We have one light and it's shaping her face. Okay? You've got to figure out, right? We've got to learn. If you're a photographer, you have to learn and understand all this stuff. Right? For me, I stare at people for a living. That's what we do, right? Some people have round faces, some people have narrow faces, some people have heavy faces. You've got to understand the different face types and what type of light you're going to bring to it. If you use broad lighting, does everybody understand what broad lighting is, narrow lighting? Maybe yes, maybe no, nobody wants to admit to it, that's fine, right? So if I'm looking this way, okay, my face is being lit, broad lighting to camera. You're actually making me look heavier, really bad. Nobody's like, hey, dude, sign me up, I want to look heavier, 10 pounds minimum, right? Nobody's doing that. And so what you would do then is you would set me up with short lighting, okay? And so you're not going to light the broad side of my face. You want to light kind of, I probably need to be a little bit over here, but you want to light that short part of my face, maybe create some Rembrandt lighting, shape her face. So in this setup, if I had had her look this way, that way, okay, we would have created broad lighting, making her face look actually rounder than it is. So we have to understand what we're doing and where we're moving that light. And so sometimes you put that light in one spot. This is where having a good assistant, by the way, comes into play. And so if your assistant understands what you're trying to create with the light and your subject, your model, your senior keeps moving, that's fine. We don't want to tell the senior not to move, but your light needs to be adjusted as well. And so if you've got an assistant who, like, if you give a reflector to and they just stand there like this, right, and they hold the reflector, fire that assistant. Because that's not a very good assistant. Light doesn't come from down here. This isn't where light comes from. Light comes from up here, okay? So first thing your assistant should know is how to raise that reflector above their head and emulate the source of light, okay? Because we don't want horror show lighting coming up from down here. This becomes very important. And so if you want to create these looks, understanding the different lighting, broad light, short light, butterfly light, loop lighting, whatever, go on, that's fine. But if your assistant doesn't understand it, you're gonna have problems. So we gotta train our assistants. The next shot, right, we came in and we used the Westcott eye lighter for this. Okay, this is, so we're still using one light. Look at what that did to her. So it's not quite the same light as this with the one light. And it's also not the same as our beauty light setup, which was this. Right, it's a little bit softer of a feel. And if we look in, we can see that very unique catch light in her eyes. And make no mistake, the catch light is also part of your signature, right? Because you can do all sorts of things. Man, if you ever watch like music videos, they'll do really cool things with the catch lights. And so imagine, everybody knows like ice lights, Jerry Yonis ice light, right? So it's just a band of light. And so imagine if you created an ice light, okay, that's four lights, like a box. That would create a box around their pupil, right? And also create some nice even lighting on their face. So your catch light can also become kind of a signature look as well, let alone what it's doing to their face and filling in shadows and things like that. Then we did something. Notice this is all happening extremely fast because it's speed lights. Everything's happening fast. We can do this on location. Corporate shots, we do it all the time. Anybody doing headshots, by the way? Handful of people? Man, you want to talk about easy money? Right, we're in St. Louis area. We get $200 for a headshot. And so what we do is we'll do, if you're four or less, we make you come to our studio, okay, to do the headshot. If you're five or more, we'll come to your office location and do it. And so can you imagine showing up at an office location? You show up for 30 minutes, okay? We get there 30 minutes before, we find a room. It's usually a conference room, by the way. We start moving furniture, set up a background. You think I got time to be bringing in giant strobes to do a shot like that? Light's gonna be everywhere, right? Speed lights are the answer in that particular situation. So we come in, we set everything up. We just did a law firm, okay? I think, I don't wanna exaggerate the number. I wanna say we shot 20 employees. Then that led to, okay, well, now we need all the partners together. Now we need all the junior partners together. Now we need the whole company together. And so that was a shoot that took us maybe 2 hours, and we made over $5,000 on headshots. And so you got to start changing the way you're thinking. Do you know what they wouldn't have wanted to deal with? Attorneys, by the way? Me fumbling with my lights. Get in, do your job, make it easy, make them look good, and get out. And so here's something else. I wouldn't do this for headshots, unless it's a boy. This is more of a boy shot. So we took two strip box, two speed lights, and put them to the side. And Joel Grimes, you guys know Joel Grimes? Right, he's real big on this kind of lighting setup. It's very dramatic, it's very masculine, right? And she's clearly annoyed. It's just those two lights, right? This would look good for a sports portrait, something like that. And are you taken away? We can do something like this in a space this big. We could literally do that right here. Nothing I'm showing you in this session requires a big giant studio. It just requires a small space where you can control what you're doing. And so those are the two different shots, right? The one on the left was that first frame I showed you, all the beauty lighting lit up for her. The one on the right, a little bit more, two strip boxes. Okay, so one on the left, six speed lights. The one on the right, two speed lights. One last thing, I think. So then we go outside on this particular day. Cloudy, overcast day. Again, none of these pictures are edited. This is as they came out of the camera. What do you know? We're looking at an image like this. What's your feeling on it? Lighting. It's natural light, but is it good? Is it flattering? Is it flat? She's afraid of light. What are you guys noticing here? This looks like a lot of photographers work when they go outside on a cloudy day, right? Nothing pops. It's flat. Look at the bad shadow. Can you believe this is this beautiful girl right here? Right? It doesn't look the same. So we've really, granted her expression's completely different, right? That's a given. But the lighting here doesn't do anything. So you can go outside and you can shoot like this all day long, and then you're gonna fix it in Photoshop, right? Or you're gonna fix it in Lightroom. It's never gonna look the same. There's no scenario you're gonna get it to look like that image on the left. It's just not gonna happen, no matter how hard you try. So what's the answer? Well, you can't bounce the flash outside, right? That's not gonna happen. You can bounce it off the clouds. You fire it directly, it's gonna look horrible. So here's what we do in a situation like this. So in a situation like this, that's Lenny. Put him to work when he comes to visit. So what we did was, right, we're firing that into, okay, a reflector and creating a bigger light source. Now, we could have done this with a white reflector and it would have been a bigger, softer light source, but I like a little bit more specular, a little bit more harder light, okay? So we're firing the flash into that and creating a light source and lighting her up. Now look at the difference in that light source. Again, completely unedited image. So this hasn't been toned, nothing. And if you look at these side by side, do you see the significant difference just by taking that speed light and doing something different with it? But are we seeing the difference here? And so let's wrap this up and let's take some Q&A on this. One, speed lights, if you haven't seen it in that whole last section, massive versatility just by moving those speed lights around. Groups are also an important part of control. Do not be afraid of grouping your lights. I know before the very first time I tried groups, I was scared to death of them. I'm like, this is confusing. Too many alphabetical letters. What am I doing here, right? And so don't be afraid of them. Also, don't underestimate the importance of those light shaping tools. And for me, it's about portability. And so it's gotta fit in a suitcase, right? I don't have, right? A gentleman asked me earlier, how many people are helping you? Is it your assistant, et cetera, et cetera? It's just me and my assistant, my second shooter. And so the more compact I can get, I'm willing to spend that money on those light shaping tools. It's worth it. Because now I don't have to bring an extra body. Now I don't have to kill myself as I'm trying to get around. Also, don't be afraid to experiment. Stuff like this is an experimentation. Maybe it works, maybe it doesn't work, but you can't be afraid to experiment. Last scene. Okay, so we're showing, I've now shown you two different ways to use this. One has been on a commercial shoot. One has been in a portrait session that can be headshots, that can be high school senior portraits. It can even be lifestyle portraits. But finally, what I want to do is show you how we use this on weddings and engagements in the real world, where we don't have time to sit there and set something up and take test shots. We've got to be able to go fast and get the shot we're looking for. So on a wedding day, time is not our friend. We need the right tool at the right time. Sometimes that tool is a B1 for me, right? So I might be using a B1, 500 watts of power because that's what I need. I might use Speedlites, roughly 60 watts of power. You have to know your toolbox and the limitations of each. If you do not know the limitations of your tools, you're gonna step out there and panic is gonna come over you the minute you take that first shot, because you're not gonna know what's happening, but more importantly, you're not gonna know why it's happening. And that's the key. You want to be a great photographer, okay? You know what I never do, by the way, is I never judge people's work. That's not my gift in life. It's not even what I want to do. Your work is your work. We're all artists, okay? What I tend to judge is your workflow, what you do to get to that shot. And so what tools you're using cannot get in the way of the shot, okay? So there's certain fundamentals of being a photographer. We have to understand light. We have to understand exposure. Right, we have to understand composition, leading lines, but let's take all that off the table. Let's just assume on a scale of 1 to 10, we're all there as a 10, okay? We can always improve, but let's assume we're where we need to be. The next thing is understanding your equipment. And I'm constantly blown away by the photographers I run into and meet with and talk to who don't understand the simplicity of just operating their camera, okay? So you wanna shoot in manual mode? Shoot in manual mode. You wanna shoot in aperture priority? Shoot in aperture priority. For one, I shoot aperture priority. That's how I shoot. Very, very rarely am I in manual mode. Now, there's a method to my madness. I can get to the shot faster than anyone in this room in manual mode. Hands down, I'll compete with any of you. I guarantee you, you want to strike fear into anyone on my team? Start talking about the exposure triangle, right? Shutter speed, ISO. Alyssa's twitching right here, right now. She's afraid I'm going to ask her a question in front of all of you, okay? ISO, aperture, shutter. So you're in a church. This is a typical conversation I have with my staff. Let's see if we can do it here. We're in a church. You're at ISO 3200, 200th of a second, F4. I'm gonna say it again. ISO 3200, F4, 200th of a second. That is the exposure of the scene. We understand, right? This is not a trick on what the exposure is. So what do we say? F4, 3200th of a second, F4, ISO 3200, 200th of a second. What's wrong with those settings? Speak up. ISO. What's wrong with the ISO? Too high. Shh. You know the answer, Ryan. You've been to my workshop.
It's too high.
ISO's too high, 3200, right? So what wiggle room do we have here? ISO 3200, F4, 200th of a second. Hold on. What wiggle room do we have?
Where? One stop.
We can adjust. It's one stop. Do we understand? But that's not really true. There's two stops. What's the first move we're going to make?
1600.
We're going to go down to ISO 1600. But now the exposure's wrong.
Shutter to 100.
Shutter to 100 is one option. So now we're back on exposure. What would the other option be? From F4 to F what? Let's assume we can go down to 2.8. So we can go down to 2.8.
And 800 ISO.
You can now go down to ISO 800, and what would we do to the shutter?
Nothing.
Nope, that's wrong.
100.
One stop, 100th of a second. Imagine me asking you this on a wedding day in front of a client, and I'm like, what? It's like, what's that movie with Keanu Reeves? Speed? What do you do? These are your settings, what do you do? And my new shooters have to know how to answer that question, because I'm not impressed because you shoot in manual mode. That doesn't impress me. What impresses me is if you know why you're shooting in manual mode, if you understand the exposure triangle, if you understand the decisions you're making. I work with photographers all over the world who shoot in manual mode and have no freaking idea what they're doing. And so that's not what's gonna impress me. You have to know your equipment. You have to understand if it's speed lights, You have to understand how to use the speed lights. It is the most boringest read, by the way, no disrespect to Canon. It is the most boringest thing to read. You know those little manuals that come with the camera? Those little green ones, right? Oh my God, those are the worst things to read in the world, right? But you gotta read it. You read it. Did you fall asleep while you were reading it?
Actually, I bought the DVD.
You bought the DVD. You got the cliff notes of it. All right, so those are the things we have to understand. And so let's go and do what we're talking about from a wedding. What do our clients want? My clients want something different. They want something dramatic. They want a centerpiece for their home. They want a statement piece. This is ultimately, by the way, how you make money. Who cares about how you light something if it's not going to translate to dollars? It's all about dollars. I got news for everybody here, man. If you're just walking around, we talked about this early on, you're walking around, you're like, oh my God, look at that. It's just so beautiful. Look at the Chrysler building. It's amazing. Yeah, it is amazing. Are you going to make money at it? No, move on. Okay? Because at the end of the day, I got to figure out a way to put a pretty girl, a bride and groom, or somebody who's going to spend some damn money to have that Chrysler building in the background. Because if they're not, I really don't care. Okay? That's the part we have to get through our head. And so, ultimately, I'm using lighting to create more than just a snapshot. That's the part we have to understand. So this is a shot. Every shot I'm showing you here was lit with a speed light. So this was shot in St. Louis, Busch Stadium. We got access to the field. Okay? Speed light is right there. And so what's happening is, and by the way, just so we're all clear, this is handheld, one assistant, and when you're holding a speed light, it's held this way. Not this way. Not this way. Not this way. If we don't understand why, it's because of the shape of the light. If I'm firing it this way, horizontally, by the way, if I fire it that way, they would have been lit from their waist up. Notice she is lit all the way down to the bottom of her dress. That is because that light's being held this way and up high. No light modifier on this one. That's how we're doing that. One light, they're looking at the light, because that's the type of portrait we're looking to create, something dramatic. Why would you create something dramatic and then have them look at camera? That makes no sense. They're cheesing for the camera. This is something, by the way, the client put 30 by 40, so about as big as this TV, on their wall, centerpiece for their home. Now, in the original shot, Alyssa's hand is right there in the frame. That's okay, we're gonna edit that out. There's no way around it, because this was shot with a 1635, okay? And the further away she gets, the more spill there's gonna be and the more power the flash has to put out in order to hit them. So what I do is when I'm creating something like this, okay, and you may not be able to see this, I'm down on one knee shooting up at them to give them more power, more drama. Remember, it's not just light that's gonna make for the drama. That's why I said if they look at camera and you're lighting them with dramatic light, do we understand why this becomes dramatic lighting? Because it's directional. It's not beauty lighting. And so because it, I'll come back to you. Because we're lighting them from the side, if I were to have them look at camera, I'm just gonna have shadows across their face. And by the way, his face is gonna create a shadow on her. So now I want drama. I want something they're gonna put up on their wall that looks more like art. I have them look away from camera and light it that way. I also get down on one knee shooting up, creating also more drama. Question?
Is that full power flash?
This particular flash, in this particular one, we shot this at ETTL. So the gentleman over here had asked me earlier, do you photograph in, would you have done those other shoots in ETTL? No, but in this, when I'm outdoors, oddly enough, as counterintuitive as it may seem, we shoot in ETTL. Here's why, and here's the process. Whenever I walk up onto a scene, here's the step-by-step process, so you're not gonna see a slide on this, so if you really care, write this down. First step when I walk into a scene, ISO low on my camera. That is ISO 50, so that's as low as the Canons will go. So ISO 50 immediately. And the reason I'm doing that is because I want to get my shutter speed below 200th of a second. There's also a method to that madness. Sure, these speed lights will work in what's called high speed sync. And so let's talk a little bit about that for a second. The minute your camera or your exposure gets above 200th of a second or 250th of a second, depending on the camera, what ends up happening for high speed sync is, right, the shutter is going to go, and what ends up happening is you get that black bar. We all see that black bar. If you've ever seen that black bar, it's because your flash is not in high-speed sync mode. And so you're getting the bottom of that shutter coming up, that curtain coming up. And so what we do now with high-speed sync is what ends up happening is even though this is happening very fast, the curtain goes up and the flash, pop, 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 pop. Sorry if I just spit on everybody in the front row. Okay? So what ends up happening there is your batteries cannot keep up. And so you'll see that happen where you just can't do it. And forget if it's a sunny day. It's never going to happen. So this is my mindset. Why am I forcing high-speed sync? Why do I need to be at 1/16th of a second here? I don't. It's a bride and groom. I'm not shooting sports photography. So there's no benefit, and I'm making my flash work 10 times harder than it needs to, and subsequently, the batteries. So what I do is I immediately go to ISO low. So as soon as we walk up onto a scene, and anybody in this room, and there's several of you here who've worked with me, know how I do this and know I'm telling the truth here. I walk onto the scene, ISO 50. I then half meter my camera. I don't take any shots. Half meter my camera to them, right? Spot metering, I'm metering to them. Okay, I see shutter speed of 2/1000th of a second. F22. I haven't even taken a single frame. I'm more than likely at F16 to F22 on this situation, okay? Now where are my settings? Typically, not always, I'm already below 2/100th of a second, right? Just from experience, I know I'm gonna be there, which means my flash is not gonna have to work that hard. Now I'm shooting ETTL, and here's where the curveball comes in. On my camera, I'm exposing for the sky. I want that dark, dramatic, I don't wanna lose any clouds, I don't wanna blow it out. My camera exposes for the sky. My flash exposes for the subject. So I'm gonna underexpose on my camera. See how dark everything is in this scene? I'm gonna underexpose on my camera, and then the light, I'm gonna expose +1, which is controlled right on the back of the camera. I probably lost a bunch of you, but that's the way we do it. And we get to this shot, I can walk out onto the scene and get to the shot in less than 2 minutes. And my clients are not watching me fuss with my light, et cetera, et cetera. So let me get through the rest of these, and if I have time, we can talk more about that setup. High school senior. Okay, I told you about the sunglasses, right? I love them, but nobody buys it. This particular senior, we literally had less than 10 minutes. That plane is on an active taxiway. So we had 10 minutes to get set up and take that. Hey, we got to push limits, man. You know, you got to do what you got to do to get that job done. This particular one, we had 3 lights set up. That flare from that one we left, we thought it lent to the picture. That's actually from the head of a 580. All right, so at this point, we're using our 580s, not 600s, on a nano stand. We had another light firing into the plane to light it up. And then we had a final light, not shooting from the ground up, but it was shooting, you can see the catch light in her sunglasses. So it was up high there. You seeing what we did there? All speed lights. And you can see the sun is coming from behind. Seeing that? This is from Chicago, an engagement session we just did recently, 1 speed light. Again, you can see the shadow. They're being lit completely from behind. That's what's creating the hair light and some separation. 1 speed light. Alyssa's arm is in the left-hand side of the frame. Whenever it's in the sky, that's what I do. I try to make sure her hand and speed light is in the sky because that's the easiest part of the image to edit. If it were in a building or something like that, that's when the edit starts looking really, really bad and fake. I don't want to rebuild a brick wall. That becomes really challenging to do and make it look natural. This is from an engagement shoot we just did in Miami about a month ago. So I hope everybody understands, I'm trying to show you real work. This is stuff I'm out actively doing and using these speed lights. So I'm not just doing it for the sake of coming here to teach you. This is what we're doing in real world practical application. And so speed light is right here. Okay, lighting them on that. Top of a hilltop, right? Big dramatic shot, right? Speed lights off camera, right? And I'm not, this, by the way, this particular shot is taken with a 7200. And so that's how far away I am from this particular shot. My assistant is up on the hill right next to the client, lighting them up with that. Last shot, I believe. This one is a bridal session we did in Phoenix or somewhere in Arizona, 2 580s, a pocket wizard, a nano stand, and that Westcott Duo rapid box. And that's what she's being lit with from there. And so she was standing in shade, and we were using that to create that drama on her and get that dark sky. So that's what we did. Underexposed on camera, so we had the dark sky. And then, of course, she went black, In order to light her, we had to push the speed lights into her to create that light for her. And they were coming right from that direction. We have a good time today?
Yeah?
Yeah. And so I apologize if that seems like it was a lot of information. I was trying to show you three very different real-world scenarios for the speed lights. Everything from commercial shoots to model shoots to brides and engagement. So I hope you really did enjoy that. Again, check us out on BehindTheShutter.com for Shutter Magazine, and then at Sal Cincotta if you want to follow behind the scenes or anything like that. And again, guys, thank you very much for your time today. I really do appreciate it.
Whether you're a hobbyist or a professional, B&H has the answers to your questions. Experience a world of technology at our New York City Superstore. Connect with us online or give us a call. Our staff of experts is happy to help.